I want you to say this prayer. Every satanic petition.
Every satanic petition.
Demonic allegation.
Witchcraft accusation.
Against me and my household. Be removed by the power and the blood of Jesus. The Bible says the rod of the wickedness shall not be laid upon the portion allotted to the righteous, so that the righteous will not reach out their hands towards iniquity. Therefore, you are going to pray, O Lord, my Father,
Oh Lord, my Father.
Every rod of wickedness.
Every rod of
in
wickedness.
In any areas of my life. Spiritual life. Physical life. Financial life. Material life. In the foundation of my life. Father, remove them by the power in the blood of Jesus. Begin to pray. Every rod of wickedness in any areas of my life. In the assigned to drag me to iniquity. Father, remove them, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Jacob say something very, Isaac say something very, very serious to Esau. When after Jacob has taken the blessing, when Esau came, he blessed him also, but he made his brother, his junior brother, to be his master. And he said to him, he said, the only thing I will tell you is that when you become restless, you will break his yoke upon your shoulder. When you become restless. So you are going to pray today. Every force that have been behaving like senior brother to my life and my destiny, trouble, circumstances, situations that have been behaving like senior brother, oppressing my life, frustrating my works. I hope you can say it all as you dictate the prayer. Oh Lord, my Father.
Oh Lord, my Father. Oh Lord, my
every
Father.
Every trouble oppressing my life and destiny.
Situation
that I've been behaving like senior brother to my
situation
life.
Situation that I've been behaving like
sickness or infirmity.
Sickness or infirmity.
That have been scaring me, oh God.
That have been scaring me.
Today, in the name of Jesus,
today
I break your yoke away from my life.
Break your yoke
away from my life. In the name of Jesus, begin to pray. Say, Every yoke of trouble, every yoke of tribulation, every yoke of violence, every yoke of oppression, hit the lives of my children and myself. Yoke of fear, yoke of financial delay, yoke of financial epilepsy, yoke of trouble and infirmity. We break you out of our lives and destiny. Today, in the name of Jesus, in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Every demon of repercussion and vengeance.
Every demon of repercussion and vengeance.
Aside against my life and destiny.
Aside against my life.
In the name of Jesus. Demon of repercussion and vengeance. Of my sins of the past. Of the sins of my father's house. Of the sins of my mother's house. Demons of repercussion and vengeance. We command it to die. In the name of Jesus.
By fire.
In the name of Jesus. Amen. You pray this one also. Every evil voice of family idol. Calling me for satanic assignment. I command it to be silenced forever in the name of Jesus. Silence them. Every evil voice of family idol, satanic idol, demonic idol, of my father, of my mother's house, of my in-laws house, silence you that I say, I command you to silence every power of darkness, evil voice of family idol, speaking to my children, speaking to my home, speaking to my wife, be silenced. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The Bible says your soul is free like a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and you are free. For your help is in the name of the Lord. You are going to call the name of the Lord. Say, Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God.
Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God.
Break and set me free today.
Break and set me free
from
today.
Every satanic chain and yoke.
From every satanic chain.
Stagnating my life and destiny.
Stagnating my life and destiny.
Keeping my life to a spot.
Keeping my life.
Pulling my life backward.
Pulling my life backward.
Jesus. If you are here today, you have been waiting on something and it's been on, you know, it's been confusingly prolonged. Mm. You don't understand, it's just been prolonged. I want you to pray this prayer. The Lord is about to reach that thing. And break every yoke and remove every hand that is holding it.
Amen.
Amen. Every evil hand of family idol.
Every evil hand of family idol.
That has placed my right upon satanic altar.
Holy Ghost fire.
Take them and take my right from me. Speak it up in the name of Jesus. Every satanic idol of my father's house, demonic idol of my mother's house, holding on to what belongs to me. You will pray this one concerning the same problem. Every strong man of my father's house.
Every strong man of my father's house.
And the strong men and women of my mother's house.
And the strong men and women of my mother's house.
Seated upon my right and my virtue. Be unseated by fire.
Amen.
You know, this is the last prayer before we sit down. There is something we always know, believe in Africa. When somebody is traveling abroad, you have your bag. Even when you are going, you be scattering all your things. You give everybody your bag, your shoe. Why do you do that? Because you think you are going to prosper now.
Yes.
You are climbing onto the plane. People say, in Yoruba language, they say, when you climb the plane, it's like climbing onto victory. But some people, many people climb, they are not climbing to any pictures. In fact, they want to collect their clothes back here, if it's possible. They want people to send that clothes back to them in America, where they live, or Britain. Because it's like from fry pan to fire here. Things they expected in Europe never happened. Some people borrow money to come to Europe or America or anywhere, but it's not happening. So you are going to pray. Every power that wants to turn journey of 40 days to 40 years for me.
Every power that wants to turn the journey of 40 days to 40 years for me.
You see, the journey of 40 days for the children of Israel, it was turned to 40 years. Even many of them did not reach the destiny. They started the journey. Only how many people got there? From the multitude of several thousands that left there. Only two. From the grown-up people that left Egypt, only two people got to Promised Land. And that is over 6,000 people. So you are going to pray. Powers that want to kill me at the end of my, at the edge of my breakthrough.
Powers that want to kill me at the edge of my breakthrough.
That want to turn the journey of 40 days to 14 years. I'm not talking about everybody, but anyone according to your family. Everybody know where it comes from.
Yes.
It does not apply to everybody here. But if you know that whatever I call applies to your home, you pray seriously.
Mm-hmm.
If it does not apply to you, you can go and eat cornflakes or biscuit outside. and come inside. Don't let me see you pass the door. I'm just joking. All those young people. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So this one is very, very, very serious.
Yes, sir.
And I want to, that's the last one before we sit down. And I want to pray it very, what? Seriously. Very seriously. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The devil is in trouble.
Amen.
I said the devil is in trouble.
Amen.
Today is your day of your breakthrough.
Hallelujah.
Tomorrow is not negotiable. Today is the day of your breakthrough.
Amen.
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 Now, they have something that is a mark. I knew that when I went to Belgium sometimes ago, some years ago. I went to Belgium to do something there. But when I finished what I went for, I went to window shopping to see whether I can get a shoe for my wife. So in the on the street of a marketplace of Antwerp, I was passing there. I saw a shoe shop there. Then I entered the place. And I entered the place, I was looking at the shoe. I saw some people, two men, they're Indians. One old and one younger one. So I know that they're Indian through the way they dread the magician. They must have been visiting Belgium. They were not, the way they dressed, they were not living there. So they carried some strange things in the hand and tied some things on their head, and they were wearing something like, I cannot describe what they were wearing. So I was looking at the shoe they were looking out to, and the lady, only one lady that was a storekeeper that was there. So all of a sudden, the younger one said, Then I was afraid. I just looked and said, what is it? That's what I didn't say it out, but I said I was afraid. I said, in my heart, what is it? Why is he shouting like that? Then he looked at me and I looked at him. He was speaking their language. Then he called the other one. In the shop, in white man country, he called the other one. And he pointed to my head. He said, and two of them were doing it. I said, hey, the white lady that was in the shop was looking at three of us. I said, what? Is this man a prince or king somewhere? So I was afraid. I said, I look back whether there's another person. I look back, I was running away. They were still following me. Like this. Then I knew that they saw the mark of the Lord Jesus upon me.
Amen.
The Bible says in the book of Galatians, it says, look,
let no
man I have put the mark of the Lord upon you. Henceforth, let no man trouble you. You will cry to Jesus today. Lord, put your mark upon me.
Lord, put your mark upon me and my house.
Let the troubles of my father's house go away.
Let the troubles of my father's house fade away.
Let the troubles of my mother's house fade away.
Let the troubles of my mother's house fade away.
Let the troubles of the land I'm living run away from me today.
Let the troubles of when the Lord Jesus lives inside of you, when the evil spirit look into you, they will see Jesus in the window of your eyes.
Amen.
They know how to see it. They will see him in the window of your eyes. Another one happened in London here. One day, a brother sent me something from America, and I went there. I was looking for a Western Union where I would collect it in London. Because we went there to do something, we were almost stranded. Because the train money that we budgeted for, we didn't know that the train from London to Manchester was that high. With the children, were about 200 and something pounds that we didn't bargain. So the brother, thank God, it was almost the time the brother one and the sister, the two of them, was the one wanted to send something to me. So I was looking for a place to get it. Then I saw a man on the road, like a madman. He was holding some book in the hand, some stick in the hand, and he was mumbling something. He was not a madman to me. He didn't dress, it was not rough, but he was spiritual man. But I called him madman because of the way he was doing and walking on the street and beer like that. And he was carrying something and was coming like this. He was passing beside, some people were passing like this, he was going like that. So he didn't have any problem with them. But when I was coming, my own thought just stopped like this. He said, go away from me. Go away from me. He didn't move again. Go away from me. I look back and say, everybody has been passing beside this man. Why is my own gaze problem? He didn't go. He said, move away from me. Then I move away to the other side. Then he began to go. Then I look and say, God, I thank you. It seems you put something on my body that is scaring some people. I was giving glory to God that day. So you are going to pray again. Lord,
God into me. Let the world see you through the window of my eyes. Begin to pray in the name of Jesus. Father, come into me, Lord. Jesus, come into me. Oh Lord, come into me. Come and dwell in me, Lord. Holy Spirit of God, come and dwell in me. Let the world see you through the windows of my eyes. In the name of Jesus. Father, come into every of my children and wives. Holy Spirit, come into my children. Oh Lord, come into my children. Oh Lord, come into my children. Fill them with your Holy Ghost and power and presence. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Don't be selfish now. Don't be selfish. Face somebody and pray for that person before you see them. Say your the expectations of your heart.
The expectation of your heart
in 2017, shall not be cut short. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. The expectation of your life in this year shall not be cut short. By the power in the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Nations of this will give you glory. Everlasting Father, we thank you.
Thank you, Father.
For what you have done, we give you glory.
Thank you, Father.
For what you are doing, we give you praise.
Thank you, Father.
For what you will do, we glorify your holy name. Have your way here today.
Amen.
Your word says, where two or three are gathered in your name, you are there in their presence.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord, because you have been there, Lord, at the beginning of the meeting.
Yes.
And we thank you for you have given us grace to be here on time, oh God.
Thanks,
glory be to your name, Father.
Amen.
Thank you for those who are here early.
Thank you
for those who come late.
Thank you
for those who are coming on the way. I'm praying. Glory be to your name in the highest, Lord. Speak your word unto us, Lord.
Amen.
Transform our body, spirit, and soul.
Amen.
Let your spirit come into us, Lord.
Amen.
Let every satanic gatekeepers that the enemy has assigned to the gates of the doors of our heart and mind and soul to hinder the word of God, let them be removed at this time, Lord.
Amen.
Let them be removed at this time, Lord.
Amen.
Out of the door in the name of
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
Out of the doorway in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. And let the King of glory come in.
Yes.
Let his word be fruitful in our
yes,
lives.
Amen.
And multiply in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Lord. Thank you, Lord. I pray for the young ones, Lord, that are listening. Lord, give them the listening heart. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth,
Amen.
Give them the heart that does your word, Father.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus of Nazareth,
Amen.
Father. Lord, lay your mighty hands on their heart and every stony heart, Father, break them to become flesh.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus of Nazareth.
Amen.
Thank you for you are the Lord. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let somebody clap for Jesus very loud. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Be seated. Sit down. Sorry for keeping you standing for that long. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, let everybody have this book quickly, please. Very fast.
Okay.
We're going to sing them from page 49. Quick. Very fast. Make it fast. Another person can give you a hand to make it quick.
49.
Page 49. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling. Page 49. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling. You can sing. You can sing it the way you are. La 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 la
softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See how the prophet is waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come on, Why should we tarry when Jesus is King? It is for you and for me. Why should we linger and Jesus is King? Mercy is for you and for me.
Come home,
come home. Time is not fleeting, the moments are passing. Asking for you and for me. Shadows are gathering and senses are coming. Coming for you and for me. Come on, come on, come on. You are willing to come on. And as we stand out in Jesus is coming. For the wonderful love he has for me, promise for you and for me. For we have seen he has mercy and pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come on, come on, come on. You are willing to go. And as we stand out in Jesus is coming, for he loves me and for me.
Father, we thank you because you are Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for your death, resurrection, and life. We thank you for the blood that was shed, oh Lord, in order to give us forgiveness of sin. We thank you for resurrection and ascension into heaven that gave us a place in your kingdom.
Yes,
glory be to your name in the highest. Fill my mouth, oh Lord, and my mind in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Take absolute control. Glorify your name. Let your word bless your children and not make them hungry, Lord.
Amen.
Glorify yourself in their lives, Father.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 Amen. So within the next few minutes, I want us to be quiet, please, and help the children also to maintain quietness. The Lord bless you.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
So if you want to write, you can take out your pen and paper. If you are reading, you read. If I'm speaking, I want everybody to be looking at me, so that you can understand what we are saying. I want to say this after me. The love of money, the root of all evil.
The love of money, the root of all evil.
The love of money, the root of all evil.
The love of money, the root of all evil.
That is what the Lord wants us to discuss today. That is what the Lord wants us to hear today. I don't know who the Lord has this for. Like I always pray for messages. I don't just sit down and begin to crack my brain and say, what do I say today? So the Lord always gives message, and I call it message. I don't call it sermon or preaching. I call my words messages. Because Apostle Paul said, my words and my teaching, they are not with a woman, what?
Philosophy.
To try to entice people. But they are in the power of God to transform people to holiness. Amen.
Amen.
The love of money, the root of all
evil.
The love of money, the root of all
evil.
So when you look at all evil around us, oh, why is the government like this? Oh, why is marriage like this? Oh, why are my children like this? Oh, what is my this like this? The root cause of all problem is what? Love of money. Not money. Money is just good on its own. Money is just good on its own. For people to buy clothes, to buy shoes, to have food on the table, and to move life forward for the daily running of their life and family. But when you had love to eat, love and money, becomes love of money is the root of all evil. The root of all evil. So I want us to listen to it very well, young people, and our mommies and daddies also, and our teenagers, as you are preparing to go into life, you must understand this principle. I was listening to some people talking on the TV during the week. It was a talk show in Nigeria, one of the Nigerian TV I was watching here. And the woman, well, one of those old women politicians that I used to know in Kwara State, and one other pastor that is also a political pastor. So they were discussing the situation of Nigeria. And the man said something that is very, very important. And he said what the president of that country is doing is good. He's trying to remove corruption. But nobody can remove corruption from any country except the Lord Jesus. Because corruption is sin. The best way the best definition for corruption is sin. If you begin to say corruption is this, that will not give it a real definition. But the real definition of corruption is actually sin. And you need to get sin out of people in order to make them incorruptible. Because if once they are seen sinful, they will be corruptible. No matter how decent you can be and good man, when you have a price, when somebody mentions your price, you will change. The only reason why people don't change is when you have Jesus in your life, isn't it?
Yes.
It's only salvation that does not make you succumb to any oppression or situation or bargain. When you are not born again, when they mention some price, you say, never, not me, I will never do it. When they mention your price, because those people used to say, everybody has price, give him something. They would say, 10,000, not me, never, I will never do that. God forbid. When they say, $350,000 cash, you say, eh? How much do you say? $350,000 cash, say, you must be joking because of this kind of small thing. This is the same person that say, God forbid. So when they mention his price, you say, how much? Then he collected it and just sign it and let everybody be. So that is the way it is. No matter, some people say, oh, some people are good when they are not born again. No good person without salvation. It's because you have not seen situation that will make you bend. Any person that you call good, when they see when you answer their question or when you name their price, they will bend. Money, love of money, the root of all evil. Every problem we have in America today is love of money. Every problem we have in Nigeria today is love of money. Every problem in the United Kingdom today is love of money. Every problem in every part of the world today is love of money. Love of money has created a lot of damage in the life of young people and old people. Love of money have made marriages broken. Love of money have made children become fatherless and motherless. Love of money have made children grow up without parents and the parents are living. Love of money have made children misbehave and disobey their parents. Love of money has made governments and nations.
Amen.
And make nations, communities mismanage the money. Imagine only 3 people stealing the money that is meant for one nation. Only the money that is meant for all nations. Oh, when you look at a country, some of the countries in Africa, I'm telling you the truth. Okay, let me talk about Ireland and talk about England. In Ireland, I don't know about any natural resources they have. I don't know about any. I just know that they were able to pay people, that unemployed people, they pay them conveniently. Not just giving them 5,000 to go and eat, but unemployed people live in duplexes. We can bear witness. Unemployed people that don't have job, they live in duplex. They live in apartment. They have car. They pay insurance and tax on their car. Unemployed. Government gives some of them as high as 600-700 euro every month. Not monthly, weekly. Every week, Friday to Friday. Friday to Friday, 700, 600, 500. If you are single, you'll get 200 and something. If you are all alone. If you are alone, you don't have wife, you don't have husband. 250 every week, Friday to Friday. Euro. Not Naira. Now, we have a country like African country, they cannot do that. I'm saying that Ireland does not have any natural resources. They don't have gold, they don't have petroleum resources to sell. They pay that from taxes, from companies and industries. The same thing in England. They pay all those things. They pay housing allowance and many people and pay tax allowances to children and also all those things. And people that don't have job are living, driving cars that, in fact, some of them have 2-3 cars in the family and no job. And they pay their bills. But Nigeria has oil, we have solid mineral and liquid mineral, that is oil and precious stones. And they now have taxes from people. Yet, they cannot give people 1,000 every month. Naira, I'm not saying euro now. I'm not even saying weekly, monthly. Love of money, the root of all evil. When they need the vote, they will come to the people, the poorest. Do you know it's the poor people that vote? How many people have noticed that?
Yes.
Rich people don't vote. People that even, forget about the rich one. People that have good jobs don't vote. They are not rich, but they are
semi.
They are executives of companies. They have good jobs. Those actors, those people that act movies, and those, anybody that live where, they don't go to vote because they think they fight there. And they kill people there. And they don't want to die. But people that are poor, when they die, nobody will miss them. They say, this problem is too much. Make I die, make I go. Let me go vote. They will stay there. If they are fighting, they will be there. Some of them will die. Those are, and why, that is why when you see their campaigning, they come to them. When they are campaigning, they go to Ajegunle. They go to all those areas. All those poor areas. Because they know they are the one that vote. They carry gari, this wrap of gari, small, and sugar. I think that is what they will eat forever. That meal of one day, not even one day, one seat, that's what they come and give them and with small amount of money.
Yeah.
And they will buy them 4 years of poverty and trouble. Love of money, the root of all evil. Pain, disaster. That is why Jesus has come. There is no government that can bring peace to any nation of the world except the government that has received salvation. Many people were celebrating Donald Trump. Oh, he's going to bring, just like they celebrated Obama 8 years ago. Oh, a young person has come. Change has come to America. What change have you seen after his 8 years?
No change.
Oh, Donald Trump is here. The Lord has sent him. Is he God? Just wait.
You've started already.
You just wait and see. You see, there is no salvation from the north, from the west, from the east, except from what? Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And the problem starts from every home. The problem starts from home to the church. All those people that are leading nation, do you know they go to church? They have pastors. They go to mosque. They have imam. But when they leave all those churches at the mosque, they become criminals in government offices. They become bandits in the House of Assembly and the House of Rep and Senate. They become criminals. They take the money that belongs to everybody to become for one person, individually, and they share it. Some years ago, Nigeria had SS crude money in the SS crude account, and they said the Senate and everybody said we have to share it. And these are the people that are supposed to represent individual people. They share the money there. That is part of the money this president is pursuing some of the old ministers to come and bring now. You see, people, for the love of money, they behave as if they are inhuman. And as you begin to read the Bible and say it, you will understand what I'm saying. And your life will never remain the same again.
Amen.
I don't know where, you know, I always say every day, if you listen to me every day, I always say, I am speaking directly to children and the young people and teenagers. They are starting lives. I don't know where they are going. They can be minister tomorrow. They can be president tomorrow. They can be commissioner. They can be head of company. Please, you must know the love of money is the root of all evil. There are many people who are supposed to live long, they are dead. Love of money. People that are supposed to live long, they are dead today. They are in the grave.
Yes.
They argue over, if you see, I was reading on the internet a case in Ireland. A Chinese man killed an Irish man. They were just fighting, he didn't mean to. They fighting, just push him and the head hit a stone. And he died, that Irishman died. And they gave the man life imprisonment. Later on, he was fighting for it and they gave him 7 years imprisonment. What did he do? He killed the man over 70 cents. 70 cents. The man came to his internet shop in Dublin. He came to his internet shop and he used the internet, he paid. The Chinese man said, I need 70 pence more. Your money is not completed. He said, that's all I have. The man said, you cannot go. The Chinese man hold him. He said, you cannot go. The Irish man gave the Chinese man a punch to leave his clothes. Then start fight started. The Chinese man do the Chinese Jackie Chan for him. And all of a sudden, this Irishman fell down, the head on the floor, and he couldn't breathe again. And the man did not know he died. When the man fell down, they said he did one sign to him, say, I don't want to mention the language. He used F language for him. The people that watch him, they testify in the court that he used that language for him on the floor there and turned back. Later on, they called him and said, this man is not breathing. 70 cents. The man died. 70 cents, as low as 70 cents. He went to eternity in hell. Because somebody that fought to die is hell. He's not going to heaven. Can you imagine that? How much more I died because of 50 pence? Because of 10 naira. People stole ordinary mobile phones, they burned them to ashes. The other day I was watching on the internet some students, promising students of a university in Nigeria. They claim, I don't know, they said they claim to stole computer, laptop, not TV, laptop. And they set the four of them on fire. Young people, from even some of them, their parents are struggling. They struggle to send them to university.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
In what? Because they want to. They said they are known to be hip hop on the campus. They gathered and said they are singing. He gave hope. Says that one, two. He had what? The father sent them to go and study. They are singing rap in the campus, and they are looking for money to promote their song. I don't know whether that's pushed them to stealing or anything. Then they kill themselves. They left the people, their parents, to be crying bitterly. Some of them, the parents will send them to school to study. They will join courtism. They will become courtesans on campus. Because they want to be fine boy, they want to make some money, they want to do some criminal things to raise money to be good on the street. Love of money, the root of all evil. Show me an evil thing, I will tell you the root cause. It's money. You cannot sort any problem in this world unless you sort the way and manner people react to money. The way I have seen marriages that is broken for money. Marriages scattered because of money. They don't care about anything, even the children that are there. It's just this money. My money. Your money. What is it? How it is? You took it. I took it. You withdraw. I don't withdraw. How much? And it become fight. I was settling a matter of a young footballer that sent his wife packing with children because of $700. And this boy made almost $10,000 every month. He just collected the salary of that month, he put it in his pocket, he has not sent it to account yet. And the wife removed $700 from the $10,000. Then he was checking later, he said, why is there $700? I put $10,000 here, this is $9,300. He asked the wife said, I'm the one that took it. I know if I ask you, he first of all gave him a dirty slap. Because the wife said, if you see me, I spoke to the wife too on the phone. Oh my, he beat me like because of 700. And he now said he will, because they were not living in their country. He said, I'll put her on the next flight.
Right.
Back to Africa. Back to home. He will go there and spend the rest. I don't want to marry her. I said, what is wrong with you? Your wife took 700 and he confessed to you that she took it. And he said, from how much? So that is how much your marriage worth to you. $700 is your worth of your marriage. He said, I don't care what you think. You are a pastor. You don't understand what I'm talking about. She's going. And she actually went. There's nothing I didn't do. I spoke to him. In fact, I went to the place he was playing. There was the time I went there. I spoke to him. He was just looking at me like this. He said, as if he heard what I was saying. He still continued to do what he wanted to do. You see, love of money, the root of all evil. When people see money, they don't have human... You don't have...
The human feeling
again. That thing is gone. No wonder people slept with animals because of money. With dog, with goat, for rituals, for money. Father slept with daughter for the sake of money. They say, this is the ritual for money. Go and sleep with your daughter. Some people, they say they need human head, 7. For love of money, in Nigeria, I went sometimes, I saw 2 dead bodies on the road. I saw one in my 2 area, another one near Okoko. One did not have head, one did not have breasts, the 2 breasts. It's not that I watched on TV, I was driving, and what bothered me is that I didn't see people gather to begin to look. People were just passing like this. I said, I had the person that was in my car, I said, Why is people not gathered to see this? Amen. We see that all the time. I said, hey.
Nigeria.
So that's what, if you see that, if that happened in Europe, everybody will gather there.
Yes.
It will be on the news, on the TV. But do you know that never came up on the news?
Because
they said they see that all the time. They will, thank God, will come and remove the body now. They don't use, they have used the head and they just drop the body. Lot of money. Love of money, the root of all evil. How did those guys walk before they cut their head and breath? They too needed money. The people that caught it also, they were looking for money. Researcher looked for researcher, and one won the other. Love of money, the root of all evil. My young people, I want to tell you again today, you must listen to me from the beginning to the end. Everything that you want to do in life, you must make sure you don't have any price. What I mean is that, don't let anybody entice you with any money. The Bible says, my children, when the sinner entice you, consent thou not. Do not consent to the enticement of the sinners. When you go to campus, you girls, you go to university, and the children, the people, they say, ah, this is how we make a small change to take care of ourselves on campus. We have some friends, we go out on weekend to go and dance. Tell them I am a child of God. I don't sell myself to take care of myself. The Lord will provide for me.
Amen.
Luke chapter 16, 13 to 31. Luke 16, 13 to 31. Love of money, the root of all evil. Luke 16, 13 to 31. A very good and fast reader. What is talking about our time? 13 to 31. Loud and clear and fast.
No servant can serve two masters.
No servant can serve two masters. Listen to them.
For either he will hate one and love the other.
You will hate one and love the other. When you are a Christian, you come to church, you claim to be born again. You cannot love God at the same time the devil. You cannot love God at the same time the world. If you have the same love you have for God for money, you have not started loving God. Amen?
Amen.
If you love God, after reading this, I will tell you what the love of money is, so that we can know that some people, they will say they are working, say, ah, they love money. Say, ah, I don't want people to say I love money. I will tell you what the love of money is. Yes, continue.
Or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other.
Uh-huh.
You cannot serve God and mammon.
You cannot serve God. Mammon means money. God of money. Yes?
Now the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, also heard all these things and they derived.
You see that? Is that the Pharisee that was there? They hearing what Jesus was saying. They were lovers of money. Yes? What did
and
they say?
He said to them,
uh-huh,
You are those who justify yourselves before men,
mm-hmm,
but God knows your heart. For what is highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God.
Mm-hmm.
The law and the prophets were all until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God had been preached, and everyone is pressed into it. And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass away than one title of the law to fail. Whoever divorces his wife and marries
It's okay. Amen.
Amen.
Now I want to jump to 19.
There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desired to be fed by the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torment and hate, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried and said, Father, Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in my water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus' evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, I beg you therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house. For I have five brothers, and that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place.
Amen. That's okay. Thank you.
Amen.
Now, you can finish the story when you get home. Now, what I just wanted to see there is a story, before I proceed quickly, the story of a rich man and a man called Lazarus. The rich man, now when you see in the place there, he said it will be difficult for a rich, that's what I want you to see. The Lord Jesus said it will be very difficult for a rich. Now we will read that later. So let me just speak of what I want to say for the sake of time quickly. Amen.
Amen.
So we had the story of this rich man and Lazarus. The rich man was very rich. Amen. Are you hearing me there? The rich man was rich and the Lazarus was poor. Now we saw the picture that the rich man went to hell and the Lazarus went to heaven. Lazarus did not go to heaven because he was poor. Neither did the rich man go to hell because he was rich. But many people don't know the meaning of the story Jesus was saying here. That's the reason why I asked our sister to read from the place she started from, so that you can understand it till the end. The reason why Jesus produced this story, he was talking about love of money. Are you understand that? Because when you read Bible, if you don't read anybody that quotes you a verse and they are talking with that verse, make sure you read the one before the verse and after it. Because if you don't, you will not be able to get the correct stories. Anybody will use that, like African people say, they will use bread to collect your pepper soup. But if you understand the preceding and the word after that, then you understand the story. So Jesus was talking about the love of money. And he gave us a story of a rich man and Lazarus. Now this rich man, I want to notice what the Bible says, the kind of lifestyle he lived. He would dress gorgeously. He was very rich. Now I want to see the picture. A poor man was at his gate. The name of the poor man was called what?
Lazarus.
Lazarus at his gate. The Lazarus was a Christian that was poor. There was sore on all his body. There was spots on his body. Bleeding up, water coming out of it. He was not just poor, he was sick, he was a beggar. Now this rich man, I want you to look at the picture of nowadays. He has a big house that has a gate. Because they said the man used to sit at his gate before he's dead. This rich man would drive into his compound and just see the gate will open. He will drive, I will see the man, I will look at him and drive past. Until he's dead, this is the way he used to drive in and out and see the man sitting down there. And again, the feeding of the poor man, they said the poor man will eat from the crumbs that fell from the table of this rich man. It's not because I want to see the picture. The rich man did not allow the poor. It's not that the poor man went inside to go and eat at the table. But what they are saying is when the Bible says food from the table, which means the leftovers, they will pack it and throw it to him at the gate. That's the meaning of that. Because he was not allowed in the compound. Then the dogs will come.
And lick his soul.
They didn't just give it to him, they give it to their dog. So this man will want to struggle, say, this jollof rice, he will send the dog away, say, this is the human food. Then he and the dog will be struggling with the food. And when they finish, they became friends. So the dog will be using the soul of his body as water to wash down the rice they have shared together. Because they were eating meat. They used to eat together, the meat together, and they were his friends. This is the life this man lived until he died. Now, what did Jesus want us to see from the love of money there that sent the man to hell? He didn't go to hell because he was rich, but he went to hell because he had only one poor man. Only one poor man at his gate for many years. Yes. He could not help him. Only one poor man, not two. Only Lazarus at his gate. He didn't know that he's supposed to take him to hospital. He didn't know that the man's supposed to be dressed very well. It's also a human being. There is no human being that dressed very well that is not presentable. When you clean them and take them to hospital, they become human beings, they become clean. Then you give them a room to stay. This man, God placed a poor man to his gate to see how he will live his life. And the poor man stayed at his gate. He didn't know that was his test to go to heaven. The man stayed there for years, for years, for years. This man was just doing big man around. Then after he died, then he was told in heaven, you failed your test. You had only one test. You couldn't pass it. This man was at your gate forever and you did not give him clothes. Haven't you read what I wrote, what I said in the book of Matthew chapter 25? That when I was in prison, they came to visit me. When I had no clothes, they gave me clothes. When I had no food, they gave me food. And the man said to him, say, Master, when did you need clothes that we gave you clothes, or food that we gave you food? He said, when you do it for the neighbor next to you, you have done it to me. Now, this man sat there, this rich man did not do it to him. He was just concerned about how he will buy clothes, how he will buy a nice car. Any car that comes yearly, new one, he will buy. Any clothes that come, Fasasi, Bushisi, Kasisi, you know, all those names they used to entice people to buy. The same engine they put in the car, they just give them different names. Mm-hmm. They make another one, they call it Pigeon. They carry Pigeon engine, put another one, they call it Kasasi. They carry Kasasi engine, they put in another one, they call it Sukasaki. And they put the boots like this. They change structure with the same engine, and people waste money on them. You see that?
Amen.
They waste money on them. You see this one I drive now? They put the engine, another one, they do the back like this. And they call it Jeep. They say, and people will be running, say, you still want to come out? Because this engine car maker, they know that people are foolish. And they need some money to throw around.
Yes.
Because if they do it the same way like this, this one don't pass.
This one don't pass.
So they put the engine, they put the another body, they package it again, they resign, they say, wow, 2018 model. They say, wow, powerful. Then they collect money. You know, the wise people collect money from the foolish ones. When you see rich people, they are the wise ones. When they play for football in that backyard, our backyard there, Manchester people, you see foolish ones, they go and sit down there. They are the ones that pay money for those young boys. When they give young boys, small boys, that just come, they are not finished for 16 years, they're having 50,000 every week. And those people, they will stay in the rain there. That's how they are paid hard-earned money to go and sit down there. They will not stay on part of the rain. Yeah. Are they not foolish?
Yeah.
These boys will not be useless in the money. They go and make design automatic wristwatch with the money of those people that sit on their side like this. When they are coming, say, come, let us hit your money. Come and look. We are playing, let us play. All of them, it is their money they used to pay them. Those people that watch. It's their money they used to pay those young boys. They don't, because they are foolish and they will not go under the rain in the cold. When you tell them to call the church in the cold, they say, Pastor, it's raining now, I can't be in that place. But they will go and watch match in the rain. And a match that will start at 6 p.m. They'll be going there at earlier at 2 p.m. 2 p.m. You see people, any day they play a match, just watch. 2 p.m. because they want to have good seats. But a service starts 11 o'clock. They say, when it's 11, you just buff it. When it's, okay, you're not going to just say, I don't want to miss Sunday school. Sunday school is not interesting. So there is just song. You say, that song is very boring. I just want to get there. Close to in middle of the message, because sometimes the message hits me, I don't want to hear. Just middle, when I don't understand anything, I just share the grace. So they will say, me, I just want to meet the grace. When I don't miss grace, I don't go to church. You know, you see people with different reasons of going to church. They don't respect God. But what I want to tell you today, I don't want to go to that area too much. Love of money is the root of all evil. The root of all evil. This man loved money. That was why he went to. He was covetous, he was greedy, and he was selfish. When somebody have those three things, they don't think about any other person. Money will be plenty, but they don't have you in mind. Have you ever seen a rich man when family people go to him? We need help. They can never sort you.
At all.
They can never help you. But they will go to party, they will be spending money like this. They will be spending money like this. They will be singing. Musician will be putting their name in the label to sing, to announce everything. But the closest people to them, that sit at their gate, they will not see anything. That is what the church too does now. The church is rich, members are poor. The church gather money together to build university, members cannot go there.
At all.
The church gather money, they build secondary school, members cannot go. The Muslim and unbeliever bring their children there. And the members that carry headpan, put offering, their children go to public university. Where they strike 6 months every year. 7 months. A course of 4 years, some people go for 10 years because of strike. And their own ministry have university. Their children cannot go there. Love of money, the root of all evil. The Lord revealed a revelation to me one day that many ministers that will not make it to him in heaven, not because of any sin, but because of a sin of selfishness and covetousness. Greed, the meaning of covetousness is passion to accumulate wealth, to be rich. Anybody that have passion to be rich, we will get there very soon. I don't want to say it before I get there. We have two more Bible passages. I don't want to take your time. Luke 18:24-30. So when somebody is telling you next time, why did the rich man go to hell? You know now. He didn't go because he was rich, but he went because he was covetous, greedy, and selfish. He had only one poor person, he could not change his life. He had only one poor person at his gate. That man did not have any impact. Even the little thing that he could do, the least, was food. Even that food was left over and was shared between him and the dog. That's as bad as the situation was. And that was a rich man. That was the reason why he went to hell. Every rich people that does not have woman in their mind, selfish, greedy, they will never see God in heaven. No matter what activity they do. Many of them do only face services. The money that they give, when they want to give for this, they'll go to pastor. Pastor, they carry Ghana must go like this. If you know you have to give, why don't drop it in the church and leave there? They have to go to pastor's house to go and give their offering and tithe. They say, pastor, this is my offering of faith. But they need prayer. It's not for free. They say, well, yeah, pastor, pray for me. That estate I want to build. They will not need that. Pastor will not say, for this money. That is pastor like them. They say, they look alike. Any pastor that be like that, they are like them. This money. You surprised me early this morning. That made a lot. Made a lot surprise you. No. That is not supposed to be. That is not supposed to be. Any money that does not go to basket, if you are there physically, it has to go to the offering basket. But if you are not there, you can send it. That is okay. That's understandable. But when you see the person face to face and you go to the same church, you keep your bag until they finish service. You now finish, you now say, call one boy, go and bring it behind the booth, let's go and meet pastor. Mm. That is no longer offering. It's a business bargain. Amen.
Amen.
It's business bargain. Yes, sir.
Amen.
Luke 18:24.
Yes, sir.
And when Jesus saw that he was very sorrowful,
yes,
he said, how hardly shall they that are rich enter into the kingdom of God?
Now, before you continue, sir, because I didn't want us to read from the beginning because of time. You know, the story there was for a young rich man that came to Jesus to be born again. And Jesus told him, say, go and sell all your belongings and give them out
to the poor.
Then you'll follow me and now make it to the kingdom of heaven. Yes, continue that, so that people can know the story. Now, when the young man discovered that the judgment of Jesus was very tough for him, he did what? Yes?
For it is easier for a camel to go through the needle's eyes than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they that heard it said, who then can be saved? 27, and he said, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. Then Peter said, lo, we have left all and followed thee. 29, and he said unto them, verily I say unto you, there is no man that hath left house or parent or brethren or wife or children for the kingdom of God's sake, who shall not receive manfold more in this present time and in the world to come, life everlasting.
Amen. You see that? Now, which means Peter and the rest of the disciples also joined Jesus because of money. That is how you know.
Yes.
Because Jesus was judging, they were there, they were listening. Jesus said, you cannot go to heaven. It is difficult for a rich man to go to heaven. It is not difficult. Let me understand it. Let me explain this to you. But when you are rich, without obeying God's word, you will not go to heaven. But if you are rich and obey his commandment, you will go to heaven. But majority of the rich people, believe me, including Christians and born again, including bishops that are born again, they are not obeying the commandment of God. And that is why they cannot go to heaven. And I will tell you those commandments they don't obey before I finish today. Now, Jesus did not know that the disciples also have mind to be rich until that day when Jesus was saying that I said, master, then who will go to heaven? Because me, I have blessed my wife and fisherman job, and my purpose is to come out. Because when you see somebody doing that kind of miracle and that number of people pursuing him anywhere they went, they were eating free, people accept them, they receive them, they give them gift. In fact, they have treasurer. Do you see that kind of, and Jesus was saying, Peter, you are my number one man when I go. He was preparing himself for the, he was warming up for the money, for the wealth. He knew that Jesus does not know how to make money. Me, I have sold fish. I caught fish, I sold fish. I know business management. This man, I just leave you when you go. Then the money will be... This miracle that we have, so, we'll build a house, we'll buy jet, we'll buy everything. We know how to make money. So when Jesus now said, I said, he was disappointed. He said, then why did I leave my fishing? You are the one that said I should leave fishing and follow you. Now you are saying that no rich man can go. Why would Peter say that if he was not open to be rich?
Yes.
Do you see that? Then the disciples too were expecting to be rich. That's why they left their job and business to follow Jesus, not for free. Then they now heard the story today. They say, that means this one is not this is not a business. I was thinking this calling is a business. I don't like this part of it. Only anointing and gift and preaching and praying. What about the money part? Then that was the problem. Every Christian, pastors, bishop, does nowadays they do things for the sake of money.
That's true.
You will see people organizing 30 days. It is in Nigeria. I saw that when I went home recently. So I went home for a program. Then I was seeing some flyers. People do 30 days revival. What are you reviving in 30 days? 30-day revival. Before they finish the revival, some people have become bankrupt among the members. They are bankrupt already. Because every day you have to pay offering and tithe 3 times in the services. I was a church, I was invited. The time for the offering was more than the time they gave me to preach. After they have collected the offering, the clinical offering, the mother clinical, and so they were just going that they would dance, they would go. They would go and they finish, they pray. Another offering, they would dance, they would go. I said, how many times did they take offering in this church? They have one, those heavy, heavy box like that, about 3 of them in front. How many times did they take offering? As if they organized program because of only money. Of course, that is the reason why they organize it. They didn't organize that you can be saved or delivered. They organized so that they can have money. And as I was growing in ministry also, when I was a pastor under a ministry, I discovered the secret of ministry from those so-called pastors that I worked under them. Whenever a church or a branch have problem with paying rent, maybe they are on the rent arrears, you know what they will say? Let us organize a program. 2 weeks. Revival. Deliverance of the children. Or marriage. They will just give you one name that will make everybody come. Children deliverance. Family marriage deliverance. Everybody will just rush from every churches. By the end of those 2 weeks, they will have excess. They will pay their rent and they will remain. Now, I'm not saying it's bad to do deliverance, but the purpose of their organizing it is bad. It's not good. Love of money is the root of all evil. Now, the people that came to the program didn't know the reason, but I knew because I was in their midst. And I did not agree with it. I didn't like it. In fact, the branch they posted me to, they suggested that to me. I said, I will not do that. I'm sorry. You are my boss. You are my superior. But I will not do that. My wife can witness. Later on, they left me with my problem. So whenever we had problem, rent, everything, they said, you go and do it yourself. We don't have money. Church, this head office is supposed to help me as a small branch that is just starting. They will refuse. They will say they will not help me. They said, go on. We ask you to do the right thing. You say you don't want to do it. You want to do it in some way. I said, that is the godly way to do ministry, is to organize program for godly purposes. Not because I need money. I will not organize because I need money. No, I will not do that. So I refused. They told me a few times, I said, I will not organize program unless you remove me there as a pastor. But for me to organize program because I need money, I will not do that, sir. I'm very sorry. I can't play over people's intelligence, people's mind. These people will not know that the reason why I organize it, they will come and I will now be raising the money. And after everything, I will pay, my conscience will not leave me. Because I am a man of conscience. Then they might not have conscience. When I'm paying the rent, I have conscience. That I've used people to pay rent. God did not ask me to do the program. But they do this thing all over. Every time, it's like their conscience is dead. This is what you see in churches. They're using people to buy cars, jeeps, everything. Flashy things, many things. In the sake, many people write books that have no meaning. In the sake of making money. And they will say, if you hear the ridiculous price they put on some books, you'll be surprised that it's a Christian book. £40, £50, £130, £120. That is not even a problem because they printed book, they want money. What about the Christian program they collect gate fee? Gate fee to attend conferences of Christians. You reserve your seat, you pay. You pay online, you pay the balance on entrance when you get there. What is the meaning of that? Is that the way Jesus has given us a church? Now, when the church is like this, what do you think government will be? The Bible says, when the righteous are being scarcely saved, where would the ungodly and sinner be? The reason why we have government like this these days is because we have double churches like that these days. Many years ago, our government was not as bad as this. Let me talk to older people now that have been around for many years. Many years ago, sir, the country you came from, was the government as bad as this one you see?
No.
Things, we were saying things were top answer, but it was not like this.
No.
I was speaking to one of our brother here about a project of plumbing work on a building in Nigeria to get water into the building. The man just laughed and said, there's no more water corporation in Nigeria. You have to dig a borehole for yourself. I said, when I was young, there was water to every house, by government.
By government.
You open your tap anytime. Now, if you don't dig borehole, you don't have water. Can you see? Are we improving or are we
getting worse?
That is why I say, the worst the church, let me tell you, the answer to the problem of the world is the church.
And the church has failed.
If the church continues to fail, the world will continue to fail. That is the answer.
Jesus.
That's why a song that says, Jesus is the answer of the world today.
Above him there is no other. Jesus is the way.
Jesus is the answer of the world today.
Above him there is no other. Jesus is the way.
You see, if the people reject this Jesus continuously, they will always continue in trouble. I don't care what religion they can be. See, it is not exaggeration to say Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. No other religion, no other person. I am not saying this because I am a Christian. I have experienced voodoo. I have prayed before like a Muslim, reciting and praying. I also consulted the herbalist in the shrine I have eaten with the masquerade. So I've done all the tradition and religions. I have discovered Jesus is the way.
The only way.
The truth.
And
the life. If you don't have Jesus, there cannot be joy for you.
At all.
There cannot be hope. There cannot be peace. There will be disaster. There will be pain. There will be sorrow, no matter how smart, educated, and religious you can be. You can go to church, be religious, and not have Jesus. You will just be incorruptible like every other politician. You can pray 10 times a day like most of those politicians. Even some of them, they will leave plenary where they do their senate. They will take excuse to go and pray because they so much love Allah. They will leave excuse to go and pray outside. But then they come back inside, they will begin to do the political game and sin and stealing of money. Is that a religion? No matter how religious, I'm sorry to say, Islam can be, because I was before on the Islamic path. No matter how religious, the greatest imam from the state I came from, everybody know that that state is a very strong Islamic state, aside from the Hausa people. That's the Kwara state.
Kwara state.
Everybody from that state know that Islamic is very strong there. But as strong as it is, every imam sin every day. Every imam is corrupt. If you want to get anything done in the village, call the greatest imam there, give him some money, he's finished. You see, so religious is not the answer. The answer is Jesus. I have looked at it left, right, front, center. Anyone that rejects Jesus cannot have a way out. There will be pain and sorrow. There will be love of money. And every problem you see in this world, it begins from the love of money. Go to every home that is broken today. Go and ask the wife in where she's living now. And go and ask the husband where he's living now. You will see that it's money that is in the root. No matter how they gather the story together to beautify it, money is the root, major root foundation of that trouble. Money. A lot of young ladies have been abused, misused, thrown away because of the love of money. There was a time when my wife was still doing hairdressing many years ago. Somebody just called her on the phone. She used to put adverts in the newspaper. Somebody called her on the phone to say, I want to do where we came from some country. We came to Ireland. We want to do our hair. We want to get our hair done. So we want to come and do it for us in the hotel. And she said, Oyibo head, 70 euro per one. Ah, they said there are plenty. I will go. I said, only you will go in the midst of Oyibo in the hotel. To go and do air. I said, okay, I'm not doubting, but tell them to come to your house. We'll come and take them. They'll come and do in the house. She called them and said, in the house. They said, no, no, they just want you to come to the hotel there. And they like, later on, they will not be sending text message. Do you do blow job? I don't know what they call that. So how can I hear that? I said, hairdresser is what you do. Which one is blow job? So I now know that they have another plan. So if I was not married to her, she would have gone there. Probably they would have locked her up there. You see? So I told her one thing that I said, why do you jubilate over any opportunity? You see, the reason why God has helped me so far and protected me, I don't jump at offers. No matter how juicy what you are presenting to me is, it is, and it looks very great, you will not see me celebrating and laughing. When you are presenting something to me, say, ah, no matter how cheap and easy it is, I will just look at you like this. He said, are you not happy? He said, I'm happy. I'm looking at the reason why you are doing that. The reason and what will happen after that. Because me, I don't jump at any offers. Every child of God, you must not jump at offers. You must not be an opportunist to be out of trouble. If you are somebody that loves to jump at any offer, you will be in many trouble. Because you don't know whether those people have plans for you. You don't know whether it's a trap. And in most cases, they use money to set that trap. They will offer you, they will pay you so amount. You will just be celebrating, say, ah, oh, Tisha, Baba Tisha, Anton Bamileru, Baba Tisha. And when you go to that place, you will not, next, after 2 weeks, they will not see you on street. You say, sister, what happened? That Odise testimony of last 2 weeks, that's the one that landed me in this place. He was not Odise. God did not do it. He was a trap. You see, some of them will not even show up quickly. It will be happening small, small before the person now fall into it finally. Love of money is the root of all evil. Don't be happy at anything that you have not worked for. Opportunities, privileges. You will see some people, they will send them, balance them, email in their box. You have one lotto of 1 million. Say, ah! I have a very big God. He's away by my side. A very big God. By my side. You will now call them and say, I want lotto. You say, yes, you just want lotto. We just need 1,005 to clear some documents for you to receive your 50 million. Say, okay, give me your name. Let me send it quickly. My name is this. And they will just send the 1,005. They will not be calling the number later. It will ring, it will not pick up again. It will not call, it will not ring again. What happened now? They just take the number. You will not see some people talking like Africa. They say, get out of that phone there. After they have received your 1,005, they say, I want my money. You are fighting for money on the phone. Don't celebrate offers you have not worked for. Be self-satisfied. Be happy with your life. There are some messages that some people are preaching around too. It's very dangerous. Jesus did not preach it. They will say, if you don't build a house, you are under the curse of the Father. If you have one house, you don't have 10 houses, you are under the influence of the curse of your mother. If you don't get a job after 7 years, the enemy is troubling your life. You have to find out whether it's really enemy. I'm not saying that there are no situations. But it's not all of them that is like that. We must not treat everybody, we must not paint everybody with the same brush. Well, many people go to hospital, but not anybody, everybody that have high blood pressure. But in the church, when I say every of these, my passenger today, customer today, they have high blood pressure. It will not be great to treat everybody with the same medication. You will kill them if you do that. Some of them don't even have any enemy at all. Their enemy is themselves. Yes. That is why a pastor, you talk to some people about their trouble. You don't just begin to go, deliverance is what you need, my sister. If you do that, you will just be misleading them. I've seen people that come to me. One lady came to me, called me in Dublin, said, Pastor, somebody gave me your number. He said, you are a deliverance minister. I said, I'm not a deliverance minister, I am an evangelist. He said, anyway, they said, you can deliver me. I said, Jesus can deliver you. They tell me your problem. She told me her problem. I'm almost 40. I don't have a husband. Every man that comes to me, they always use me and dump me. This. She talk. I say, are you born again? He said, yes, I'm born again. Because I don't pray for people that are not born again. Because you need to be born again to know what problem you are left with. If you are not born again, you are entitled to have any problem in the world. And when you are delivering people that are not born again, you are wasting your time. So if you are not born again, we start from salvation. Then the Lord will deliver you from the rest. So are you born again? She said, oh, I'm born again. I said, give me the story of how you are born again. She told the story, I was laughing. She thought when you go to church so much, you become, when you stay too much, around, when they put leaf with soap, very long, the leaf will not become soap. Because she has been going to church since she was 18. She now thinks she's a born again Christian now. I sing a choir of Onicha. When I left there with my, I went to Abba and I sing. She was telling the story that I was young married. When she finished, I said, is that what you call born again? She said, yes. I work for God. I said, ah. What is this one talking about? You think when you walk in the church, it's born again? I said, okay, she said, Pastor, I'm born again. I said, you are not born again. She said, Pastor, I'm born again. I said, okay, let me help you. He said, Pastor, if you cannot deliver me, let me know. It's deliverance I need. People recommend you. I said, let me help you. I do deliverance for people that are born again, that have problems. But your own, you are not born again. He said, I am born again. I said, you want me to tell you? He said, Pastor, but you don't even know me. I said, let me tell you the reason why you are not born again. Those men that come to your life and dump you, how many of them did not sleep with you? She not talk again. I said, hello. I thought she already dropped the phone. I said, sister. He said, eh, I'm here. How many of them did not sleep with you? He said, all of them did. I said, then, are you born again now?
You are not. Because if you are born again, you will not do it.
I said, that is why they all saw you like a ping pong. Somebody that said, I want to marry you, now go easy. The road open straight. You now say you want to take you to altar tomorrow. You say this one, if another man come when I travel, they go take her to altar like that. I don't want to marry this kind of lady. She's very easy. Men, they like somebody that give them tough time. Say, no, never. I'm a child of God. If I am not married, that cannot happen. I say, if you say that to any brother, they will end up marrying you. Because you don't say that to anybody, that is why they cannot marry. Because they think you are not a Christian you profess yourself to be. And they want to marry Christian. You think they are foolish? They might be under pressure, but they are not foolish.
At all.
When they are under pressure, they try to persuade you and you give in to that. Then later they will just say, that girl is not the kind of girl I'm looking for. I want a Christian. Even though he's the one that persuaded that sister, he will not come say, I want a Christian. Is he a Christian himself?
No.
You see, that's why I used to tell ladies, don't be foolish on the altar of boys, on the boys' altar. They use you and they tell your story. They are the one. Have you ever seen where boys they begin to discuss how they use somebody? Say that one. You try your best to have done very easy. Go, I'll give you a number. This is very easy. Go and try a while. I'll finish with that. And they will not be sending themselves to only one girl. And the lady will not be doing on the street like this. You don't. They are finished out. Someone that don't have any value anymore. By the time you hear your story, then you just say, you run to go and stay somewhere. The root of all evil is money. Don't have, you see, it is good to work and get paid. It is good to say, pay me my money, I've worked for it. But what do we call love of money? When you have this trinity attached to money, we are going to see it now. Let's open to the book of 1 Timothy chapter 6, 6 to 12. 1 Timothy chapter 6, 6 to 12. I'm happy today. Everybody is coming along with me. At least I've not seen any eye closed. Glory to God.
Timothy chapter 6.
1 Timothy 6 to 12. 6 to 12.
But godliness and contentment is a great gain.
Godliness and contentment is a great gain. What is the meaning of contentment? To be content. In French, they say content. You are happy. Or in English, content. You know, you are happy with what you have. You don't have what you want, but you are happy with what you have, in the hope that God will prove it will take you to the next step you are going. Satisfied with what you have. Don't go to a church where they will preach to you the way you get out, you now begin to say, where money? These people preach to me, they have been wasting time since. There are many people that preach to people that make them backslide. I backslided a few times as a Christian. The first time I backslided was a message of a man that they invited to our church that I was going. An evangelist. A so-called evangelist. He preached. He said, how many people have I was in Africa. How many people have international passports here? I didn't raise up my hand. Evangelist. He said, if you don't have eternal pastor, you are not a child of God. You don't have any hope. You don't have any future. You are here in Nigeria, you don't have passport. That means you don't have, you don't have faith to travel. Then he began this travel story. London story and everything. Then my head sparkled after the message. I didn't go to church regularly again. I was looking for passport. I was a teenager. I was looking for passport, how to travel. I'm not a child of God if I don't have passport. Ah, God, where is your glory in my life? Father, where is your glory? My passport is your glory. Going to London is your glory. Ah, Lord! There are messages that make people far away from God. And there are messages that make people close to God. So you must be careful. Be happy with what you have. You can plan your way, but don't let anybody talk you into becoming out of hand. So women, they will go somewhere, they will talk to them, they will now go home, come back to their husband and say, you, I don't mean you for a long time. You will think it's just a matter of now. It's because they hear some story there. Nothing happened now. The man has not offended anything now. But because he just got some story, he just came home. The man said, welcome. Say, why is they giving me a welcome? Which kind of welcome is that? Look at the way he says, welcome. I mean you. all your men, they have a lot of money. They have business. You just see that. That is because of conversation that they had somewhere. He brought it to the home and it became trouble. And the man said, what did I do now? He said, what did you do last week? Next time. This thing. Why is this? Why are you looking at me like that? And you just see, you don't even know what is causing trouble. You must be careful. Love of money is the root of all evil. Don't let anybody put things into your mind. Don't let anybody push you against yourself, husband and wife. Don't let anybody tell you that your husband is not successful like their own husband. Because if they have opportunity, they will marry your own. That one that you think is not good, they are hiding it. Some of them want to even carry your book. There was an Ivory Coast comedy. That man, he was just taking, he sent the things of his wife out. Another, you know, they live opposite door. Another man just carried the bag and put it inside his own room.
Yes.
The man, he didn't notice. The woman was crying. The man did not know anybody is carrying it. So when he finished, he just see the bag on the floor. He said, he had the last one in his hand. He asked the woman, where's your bag? He said, the man was just carrying it. Just leave it there. And that man said, in his presence, the man carried it. He said, what is your problem? Why are you carrying my white bag? He said, you don't need that anymore. No? It's finished with you. Let us begin another life with me. He said, So, you are my enemy. You are the cause of our trouble. You have been hiring my wife since. Now, he said, my wife, please. Honey, let us solve our problem. Please go inside. Will you bring my wife back out? You see that? Some people are looking at what you say you don't like. They want to have it. They are waiting at all costs. So, don't mind what they are saying about it. Don't mind the counseling and information. You just focus on the person you have business with. Whether the person is successful, it's not their business. Whether it's not, it's not their business. But when you team up with that person, you cooperate in the spirit, in the truth with that person, they will be successful.
Amen.
You see, the reason why any man or woman will not be successful is because of the level of cooperation of their husband or wife. That's the secret of marriage. When you see a successful man, you check the way their wife is to them. When you see a successful woman, you check the way their husband is to them. That is the secret. When the devil does not want a man to prosper, they will instigate and manipulate the wife. You see? So, therefore, whatever he's doing, they will not be part of it. But if a wife can be part of whatever the man is doing, wholeheartedly like the man, believe me, the sky is your limit. And what you don't know is that while you are doing that, you are creating your own opportunity for yourself. Any woman that supports husband, they are only creating their own office. By the time you think you are helping your husband, you see your own office being created too. Mm-hmm. And I say, so I have office at the end of the day. And you'll be happy at the end of the day too. So when the devil is using the husband and wife against the husband, he's also fighting against the woman not to prosper. Mm-hmm. Because the woman is two things to her husband. A woman is the gatekeeper of the house. And she's also the seed bearer. You carry the spiritual and the physical seed. The physical seed is the children. The spiritual seed is the power, the completeness of the man to become one. Because if you are not one, you cannot be successful in this world. You must be a complete man to be successful. So when the woman joins you, that's why when you see some marriages, the man is not too okay before he marries. But as soon as the woman comes in, then things begin to go. door begin to open, business begin to grow, the opportunities begin to come. They begin to buy things in the house. Maybe they just had one room before. Now they move to apartment, from apartment to duplex. Everything will just be changing because of only marriage. So marriage is not only a spiritual thing. If you walk according to that spiritual law, there is going to be prosperity. But if the spiritual law is not in place and it's catastrophe, there's going to be also catastrophe. Amen.
Amen.
Love of money is the root of all
evil.
Yes, sir.
For we brought nothing into this world.
We have brought nothing into this world.
And it is certainly we cannot carry anything out.
You cannot take anything out of the world, no matter how rich you can be. They cannot bury you with 1 million. In fact, $100 bill, they can't put it inside of your body. Otherwise, some people will come in the night to remove that dead body.
Dead body.
Ah, $100. That is equivalent to 400. The people that are there at the mortuary, they'll be waiting. Yeah. Let them go home. I need that bill. They will remove it, no matter how many security are there. So nobody takes anything out of this world. We came to this world like a baby, naked. And when that person is going through, it will be naked. The hands will also be like this. The same way you came, that's the same way you go. Why now trying to get all those things that you cannot go to anywhere with?
My homies.
You sacrifice your marriage. You sacrifice your peace. You sacrifice your health. Do you know people carry drug in the tummy? Sacrificing their health to travel with. And a lot of people die in the course of that. I have done it before. During the time I had love for money, swallowed pieces of drugs, capsules, wrapped big like this, traveled with it. What about if I have there? If I have been killed by those things, I will not be preaching to you today. Some of my colleagues died. There was a man that died. He swallowed some stuff. He was not properly wrapped, and he lived and he died. You see, I know some of them that. When the thing was supposed to come out, they didn't see it. It didn't come out with the rest. They were looking for the two pieces. For days, the thing was not coming out. For days, it was not. They were contemplating operation because it was dangerous. It would die. I was a Christian at that time, a teenage Christian. I was praying. Say, God, let this thing come out. Oh, Lord, let this go. A disobedient prayer warrior, I was. Disobedient servant. A religious unbeliever. That's what I was. But I thank God for saving me and opening my eyes.
Amen.
But there are some people that think they can use the name of God to go and pray in the shrine. To pray for the dirty business. To use the name of God, some people, they will be going to duty. You know, in the evening. You know what I mean? Those people that go to evening duty on the street. They say, Jesus, Father, my Lord, I'm going today. Let your presence go with me. Protect me. They love God. They are religious. But they are not doing the will of God. That's the kind of person I was. I will carry drugs in the hotel room and I will pray. I will need them. Father, I'm going to the airport. Father, I need your help. Protect me. Defend me. I was Christian all the way when I was doing this. But I was a religious Christian. I did not realize that I had to, if I have to be a child of God completely, I must leave what I do. That thing. But I give glory to God for letting me see that. So you must know the love of man. The day I left the business, I decided to leave, was when I was almost caught. Apart from the one I swallowed, I had some in the bag. And I got to a checking place, and they found out that I had some stuff in the bag. They asked me to take it to somewhere to re-examine properly. And the man said, what do you have here? As soon as I said that, I know that it was finished for me. I was counting how many years did they give here. That was what I was thinking. Then I was thinking about my mother that was old. I was thinking about my brothers, that everybody depended on me. I was saying, how will my mother handle this story? What will my brothers do? My mother will just die. So I was shaking, but I was trying to control myself. They say, carry the bag and come this way. I took the bag, I went there, I stayed. I tried to come. They say, what is there? I said, my padlock, key holders, polish, dish. That's how the things are there. I said, are you sure? I said, Father, I was praying. He was saying that I was praying. Because I was a Christian, disobedient Christian. I said, Father, if you can save me now, this is the end of this business. I will serve you for the rest of my life. Give me another chance, God. I don't want to go to jail. And as soon as I said that, instead of man to open it, he said, where are you from? I say Nigeria. I say, are you Igbo or Yoruba? I say, I'm Yoruba. I say, oh, Yoruba don't do drugs. Carry your bag and go.
Oh, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
He didn't open it. I said, thank you very much. Thank you. After then, I said, oh, you know when you just escape something? I said, oh, oh, God. Oh. I couldn't wait to dispose all these things. I couldn't wait to just dispose everything to the person that sent me, because I was sent, not me. It was not my business. You know, y'all use me for as a carrier. I just said, I want to dispose this and just forget about this and live a new life. So I thank God for saving me.
Amen.
I thank God for saving me. And Amen. Then I made up my mind, said, never again.
Amen.
No matter how much trouble I have, financial trouble, I will never do this again.
Amen.
That's the decision you need. Love of money is the root of all evil. Many people are in jail. I have friends that ended up in jail. They didn't quit. They end up, I heard their story, they were in jail. I have friends that died through the course of those swallowing those things. Because love of many make you end up in many things, in the mortuary, in the graveyard, in any places, in the police custody, in prison. Love of money is the root of all evil. That is, if you are lucky, you end up in prison. Some people, they end up using their body part because they love money. Some lady, when you call them, they say, ah, Kike, where are you? There's one man that want to offer us $2,000 now. They say, eh, where? I'm coming. And they might never come back home again from that simple call.
Mm-hmm.
They will never return back home again if they are not lucky. Some of them that are lucky to be alive, they end up alive having diseases. HIV, AIDS, gonorrhea, gonococcus, and many other gonos. You see, love of money is the root of all evil. In Ireland, I'm seeing women, do you know, sir, women going to a club in the night, they will buy chewing gum. I don't know that kind of business they do there. They buy chewing gum, they buy perfume, they buy some other things, and condoms. They now go to club, nightclub, they stay at the door of the toilet there. They said they will be selling it to anybody that come. Somebody told me I was not there. I didn't see any of them. Because somebody mentioned that name. I said, what business is that? He now explained to me how it works. You go inside the toilet of a nightclub, and when people go to the toilet, you stand there and be selling those to them. And from there, some people have been maltreated by some drunk men. They just handle them anyhow, And they now begin, hey, you want to rape me? Who sent you there? Some of them are married women. Love of money. Why did they, I asked one of them, why did they go and say some drunk people, they make the thing to give them $100? Instead of something that they sell 20p, they give you £100. You now want them, you don't want them to touch you at all. Love of money is the root of all evil. Tell me anybody that have been raped before, frustrated, tormented, manipulated, majority of them, love of money. Love of money. Continue, sir.
And having food and raiment, let us deal with content.
When you have food on your table, when you have clothes on your body, be happy. While you are praying for God to do another one. That does not mean that you cannot work or try to apply for school to go to school, but you must not do everything for the sake of money.
But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts.
You see, another translation said, those that desire to be rich fall into many traps. Desire means when you want to do something passionately, wholeheartedly, without looking at anywhere, you just want to do it by all means. That's what they call desire. Anyone that wants to be rich at all costs, by all means, they will fall into many traps. And they will fall into the ditch that they will not be able to come out. Yes?
Perdition.
And destruction.
10.
Mm-hmm.
For the love of money is the root of all evil, which why some convert after they had erred from the faith and pierce themselves through with many sorrows.
Amen. Thank you, sir. You see, that's where I want to stop. Thank you, sir. The love of money, let's say it together. Love of money is the root of all evil. Say it. Love of money is the root of all evil. So if you want to be happy, how many people want to be happy in life? How many people want to live long? How many people want to have good health? Then you must check your love for money. How do you know whether you love money? Three things. Selfishness, covetousness, and what? The third one?
Greediness.
Whatever you do you have greed? And what is the meaning of greediness? Your desire to accumulate wealth.
For yourself alone.
You have, it's not that you have, you still want to have more. You still want to have more and more and more and more and more. You are not satisfied. You build three houses, there's nothing bad with building 4, 5, 10 houses. In as much as you can do other things too. In as much as you can help the poor man at your door. Because we told you the story of a rich man and Lazarus. Because a rich man wanted to build more houses, so he forgot that he had a poor man. So if you want to build, if you have money to build 10, you can build, but you must help people that are coming to you. You must help people that are coming to you. But if you say, I don't want to help because I have a project and project and project, I don't want to help anybody. That is what churches do. Churches, when they build this cathedral, they will need money. They will need money. They will need money. When they finish, they'll say, we want to build another big stadium. Church, they will need money. They will need money. When they finish that, church always have project and project and project and project and project.
Not remembering.
And they will not help anybody that is poor. They don't even want you to come to tell them that you are having problem. They will say, we are not organizing charity. And they got charity number. Church will tell you, we are not organizing charity. And they have charity number. That's what they told government. So you are charity. Let everybody come and ask for what they need. Because it's a charity. But when they are running it, they will not tell you. They will say it's not charity. But it's a charity.
And that's lying.
So when you now use a charity to accumulate wealth, then it's no longer charity. Do you understand what the problem is now? That is what the government have problem with all churches of the world now, including Nigeria. Because they want to see to that now. That when you call something charity, let people benefit. Because that's why we give you charity number. When you build university, the white evangelists that came to Africa many years ago, they built school. People went there free.
Free education.
But now we are building church, people are going there with not even the same levy as the government own, but two than three of the
higher.
Government own.
Higher.
That is not charity. And to me too, it's not charity. If we cannot maintain a school without collecting fee, let us not do school project. Let us help the school that already exists. The money I want to use to build my own university, let me look for University of Lagos. What is your problem? Why are you striking all the time? Let us help government to pay your salary that they owe you. So that you can keep on running for these people to go. That is charity. That is what God wants. Many ministers of God will not go to heaven because they are not doing this. Instead of helping an existing government university, they are building their home at the expense of punishment and pain and sorrow of the poor student. They will not go to heaven. God has not sent any minister to build university. It's to preach gospel. But if you have money, at the same time you can help, you can build it. But you don't build it and say because you are building it, you cannot help. It becomes useless. It becomes hell, no legal heaven. We must learn from the story of rich man and Lazarus. Anyone that you see around you is your neighbor. You must help them. Any project can wait, can be placed on hold. You can help people. If you are doing projects and say because of that project you cannot help anymore, you are no longer in the plan and purpose of God. You can have all the building and all the houses and be heading towards hellfire. This world, we can only spend 100 years if you are so lucky, fortunate. After then, where do you go to spend your eternity? Is it heaven or hell? We see the rich man here. He was begging for ordinary water. And they told him, they say, you already enjoy your own life. When you were living, you enjoy. Let the Lazarus enjoy himself now. He said, please, can I beg for a favor? They said, what is it? He said, can you go to my family? Send somebody from here to my family to tell them to repair their way, not to do the way I did. To be generous. To be giving. To be helping other people. People in need. People like Lazarus. To help them so that they can get to heaven. They will not come to where I am. They say, we are sorry, we can't do that. They have prophets. They have pastors. Let the pastor deal with that. If they cannot believe pastors, then they are not deserving to come here to heaven. I'm telling you today, so that don't wait until you get to hell. You will not go to hell in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Anything that you have, Anyone that you are able to help, don't pull back from doing that. Assist, support. Church don't preach helping people anymore. They only preach bring to church. Pay your tithe, pay your offering, help the man of God. It's not only that. The only thing you hold the church is the tithe. The one you hold yourself among members is help, offerings, help, assistance, support. You don't just bring all the money to church. You must help yourselves. It's not only church that need money. You need money too. A brother is in the church that does not have money. Somebody is there that needs something. He's praying for. And he's in your custody. And we now bring everything to church. Instead of looking at how to sort the people that have problem. Please, we go to heaven by helping, not by paying tithe. That's what Jesus said. If you have done it to the person, anyone that is next to you, you have done it to me. Tithe is also very good. That is not saying that tithe is good for running the church and the affair of the church. That is the only thing every Christian owes the church. That is the truth. If anybody stand up in the church and say, everybody should bring 200, that is satanic. That is robbery. The only thing you give voluntarily is your tithe. Every other thing, willingly. You can say, church, take this. Willingly. Not that somebody will raise money or will now begin to raise. We do what we can afford to do as a church. If you cannot afford it, let it be. Not by force, not by fighting. Because the love of money is what?
The root of all evil.
And you begin to love money by what you do. You don't just love money because you feel like loving money. But when you put your hand in some project that you cannot handle, you now begin to see yourself striving, struggling, because you want to get that things done. When the church go to rent a big building now, warehouse, when they cannot afford it, they will begin to drain the members. Sucking members to pay the rent instead of preaching the truth to them and let them have their life after paying their tithes. So please, love of money comes from the things you overreach and you do by force. So don't do things by force. That's what the book of 1 Timothy tells us. To anybody that desire to be rich at all costs or do the things they cannot handle, they strive, they force themselves to do it, they will fall into many temptations because they will be running up and down. They will fight people on the course of doing it. They will fight this one. They will fight that one. If somebody hold them, they will fight because they want to get that thing, to sort that thing quickly. They will not be patient when they have to be patient. So please, the only thing you can do that is not by hearing me and go and act, is by repenting from your sin today. Because sin can only be taken care of by salvation and the blood of Jesus. Amen. You cannot do anything if you don't have genuine salvation, if you are not cleansed with the blood of Jesus. So I want you to renew your strength today in faith, renew your salvation, and you know that you need to get out of your life the love of money. See, the first way you can get rid of it is by looking at money as what?
Paper.
As what?
Paper.
Ordinary paper. They just designed it and they placed a law that if I wrote something here now and sign it and I say I have power to say anybody that sees this should take it from you as money. Everybody will take it. So they signed the printed paper and they signed it and they said this is a legal tender in our country. Everybody should receive it for any amount. And that's why it become powerful as money. Why do you run after it? Why do you? Some people forget that they have children because of it. Some people, it's only outsiders that took care of their children growing up. When the children are not grow up, they're not going to say, this boy, I don't know where I get this character from. Not from me, what, not from my father. Ah! It's from the people that train him up. Because you let everybody train your child up in running around for money. Day and night. Some of us don't see the children. And we're just running. When you finish running, who is going to be in charge of all those things? Is it not the same child that you didn't train? And when you now leave the child with him, just sell everything one day to smoke Igbo and cigar, God forbid, will not happen to us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Love of money is the root of all evil. If you see a drug addict, go and ask them the parents the way they took care of him. Find out the kind of home bringing. It's not every drug addict that becomes drug addict because they want to be. Go and check the statistics in America show. When I was writing a book that is called Ultimate Deliverance, I was trying to make research. And the statistics that I got to know, it really surprised me. They said majority of the drug addicts in America, the prostitute, and all those people in jail, majority of them are from single marriage.
Single marriage.
even in UK.
Yes. It's either they live with the father alone or with the mother alone. So the distant children, they are the ones that the parents brought them together, husband and wife. It's only one you will see successful. Those ones that just narrowly escape, that become successful as a single married product. Don't let, I speak to our parents here today, if you are here under my voice, don't let paper to make you misuse your wife or husband, to make you abuse or insult. Even if you give them cards, this is my card, go and take 100, and you end up, they see 120 there. That is their own dishonesty. But don't let it be a fight. It happens between me and my wife. I'll just say, take my card, go, and she comes back and say, in fact, sometimes she might forget to tell me. I will just see her lad. I say, hey! During the Christmas, one of them happened. I just saw her lad during the Christmas. This past Christmas, I say, ha! The balance. Then she came and said, how much? Say, I said, but I told you this. I said, I saw some other. I said, okay, that's it. Did you fight about it? Did you say we'll not eat? She cooked the thing. I know that the thing is still useful for the house, whatever it is. But it's just that that's not my plan. But it should not cause trouble. Everything that you hold belongs to her. Everything he has belongs to you. You must have that mind. I don't encourage husband to have separate account. It's not good. It's not what? It's not good. It defies home. It divides everything. It causes trouble.
Also.
But also the men. I must be fair. People that know me, they know I'm a very frank somebody.
Yes, sir.
If you are not born again, man, don't have the same account with them.
Okay.
If your husband is not born again, they cannot have the same account with you. I'm a very frank somebody.
Yes,
I don't deceive people. Because the only person you can trust is a born again child of God. Because anything can happen, a child of God will not leave you. A child of God has given his life to God. He has the feeling and the truth and the passion of Christ. But when you see your husband is born again, please believe him with all your heart. Put all your life to support him. Defend him. Support him. Pray for him. Fast for him. Because when you are doing that for him, you are doing for yourself.
For yourself.
Fight for him day and night. You are doing for yourself. May the Lord have mercy on us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Shall we stand up in prayer? I want you to tell God, tell the Lord now. Speak to him. Lord Jesus, have mercy on me. Touch my soul. Touch my body. Touch my spirit. Redeem me today from the love of money. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Save me, O Lord. Have mercy on me. Begin to pray in the name of Jesus. Let the Lord deliver you from the love of money. In the name of Jesus. Deliver me, Lord, from the love of money. Have mercy on me, Father. Have mercy, Lord. Deliver me, Lord Jesus. Deliver my children, Lord. Deliver my wife, Lord. Deliver my home from the love of money. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
That wonderful name.